Greetings, everyone, and welcome to another edition of In Studio. I'm your host, Ted Perch, and this morning we're in the studio of Ruth Sanderson, illustrator and artist, and we're going to be talking to her about her artwork. And by way of introduction, I'm going to read something that was written by Jane Yolen in Ruth's book, Golden Dreams. There are only a few modern illustrators whose feet I grovel at, kiss the hem of the garment, worship at the door of. Their constant inspiration, sheer talent for drawing, prodigious output, attention to detail, and glorious color simply knock me over. I count the Dillons, Maurice Sendak, Barry Mosher, and Eric Carle among them, and Ruth Sanderson, the goddess of Cottage Street. To sit as I have in Ruth's studio and watch her paint is like watching an old master of work, at work. And yes, in an era of computer graphics, she still uses canvas and paints. As glorious as those paintings are, as filled with detail and architectural wonder, yet she can finish one of them in less than a week. It used to be 3 days, but she's slowing down a bit with age. So there's that's your introduction. There's that's pretty much says it all. So welcome to the program.
Thank you.
This is great.
It's great to be here.
Now, you've been at this painting for most of your life. You grew up not far from here in Munson, and you spent a lot of time outdoors, a lot of time in libraries.
Yes.
Apparently your grandmother was a librarian in Palmer. And so books and fables and everything that's in books became part of your work.
When I was growing up, I loved books. I loved the library. I loved reading, especially fairy tales mm-hmm. and horse stories. The Walter Farley Black Stallion books
yeah.
were my favorite books growing up. And also Grimm's fairy tales.
Me too.
And I loved playing in the woods and imagining fairies in the woods
mm-hmm.
with my friends.
Yeah, when you grow up, I grew up in a rural area as well in Connecticut, and we had a patch of woods behind the house with a stream running through it, and it was our stage. You know, we had played cowboys and Indians and everything in the woods, and you know, imagined creatures, and it was kind of like Lord of the Rings.
Mm-hmm. I remember skipping down an old country road with some friends mm-hmm. and singing "Lions and Tigers and Bears, oh my!" from The Wizard of Oz.
Yeah, yeah.
That was another great iconic.
Now, I read on your website that one of the things, and I found this really fascinating, that in those woods there was an old theme park of some sort?
There was an abandoned theme park, and it was actually in Wales, Massachusetts.
Wales, yeah.
And they were only open for 1 year and then closed due to lack of funds.
Yeah.
I guess it didn't really take off
right.
in the middle of nowhere. And my friends and I would go and play there. It was only about a mile or two from my friend's house, and it was down this country road, down this dirt road, and all of a sudden, there in the woods was a pink castle.
Oh, are you kidding?
The Snow White's, the Seven Dwarfs cottage, stone cottage, which apparently I just found out was actually there on the grounds when they built this theme park.
Yeah.
I've just been investigating this again. And that cottage was built by a German man, like years and years and years, you know, like 80, 90 years ago. So that image, I think, really informed my, I don't know, my psyche and just intensified my love of fairy tales, and probably is one reason why I'm writing and illustrating them today.
Well, I grew up on Grimm's Brothers fairy tales, too, and I don't remember the edition or anything. This was a long time ago. And this, that whole, the landscape and the places it takes you and puts you into these places, in the castles and the whatever Middle Ages sort of Europe and Germany and those little houses and stuff and witches and trolls and Rapunzel and all that kind of stuff. It's very rich kind of imagination to acquire.
And it's enduring. You know, fairy tales
yeah.
have endured for just how many hundreds and hundreds of years. And of course, we retell them a little. We tweak them a little when we retell. Sometimes, you know, you do the original version, but you know, often someone who retells will tweak it a little, and then some people twist them and make them really wild and crazy, which is a really fun thing to do too.
Well, the stories are all about good and bad and human behavior and what to watch out for and what not to do, and you know, how to succeed and to persevere over, you know, problems and challenges that come up in life. And it was a way of transmitting that kind of information before people really wrote. So here you are as a kid in rural Massachusetts, and you begin painting. So tell me about that.
Well, as I said, I loved horse stories, and I loved horses. Mm. So what I drew from the time I could hold a pencil was the object of my desire, which was a horse. So I drew horses constantly. And then when I was about 14, I got an oil painting set for my birthday or what have you, and I started, my first painting was a horse.
Yeah.
I painted a horse in oils.
And
I just felt like oils was my medium.
Yeah.
And of course, then I went on to go to art school for 4 years in Connecticut, the Pear College of Art, and got a very good traditional education there in grounding in basic drawing and painting, and also in illustration and in children's book illustration.
Right.
Happily be in the right place at the right time when it was really the boom of children's book production and availability and a market in stores for children's books.
I illustrated the very first editions of the Black Stallion books, the very first covers that were for the first paperback edition ever done. And I was lucky it was my dream job. You know, I loved these stories growing up, so to be able to illustrate them.
Illustrate them,
You know, pretty much just a couple years out of art school. That was one of my first big jobs.
Now, I can imagine that any parent who's brought their kids to a public library have seen your illustrations. Even not perhaps knowing it specifically, but I've seen your illustrations, and some of your illustrations I'm familiar with. I'm a retired director of a public library, so being involved with children's literature was part of my job. And as I look at your drawings, I've seen that. I've seen these illustrations. I remember that.
That was actually one reason I did this volume, which is an art book.
Yeah.
So Golden Dreams is really. You know, my career as an illustrator. So it really catalogs everything from doing a version of The Little Engine That Could to the Black Stallion covers.
I did a lot of Nancy Drew
work. Really?
I did 17 covers and 4 completely illustrated ones. I got to meet Carolyn Keene before she passed away.
Yeah.
And
so I've had a really interesting career, and then went on to retell and illustrate fairy tales. Started actually by Jane Yolen, who wrote Sleeping Beauty, which was the first fairy tale that I illustrated. And then I went on to retell them myself for a number of years with Little Brown. I think I've got 8 or 10 retold fairy tales, such as The 12 Dancing Princesses and Cinderella, an Italian fairy tale called Papagatto, The Snow Princess.
Mm-hmm.
So, I've had a great, great career.
So, from what I read, you've basically been illustrated like in 75 different books and titles.
I think I've done. It might be up to 80 now. 75 or 80.
You're still working.
I don't count. I lose count sometimes.
Now, the one thing I notice about your paintings or your illustration is that your use of color. Which is complicated, but it's lush, and it's there's a certain sort of enchantment that happens with how you do this. And so let's talk about that.
Sure. I always plan my books very carefully, and the color is extremely important, and also the sense of light.
Right.
I want you to feel like you can see the sun shining in the picture, and that there is a source of light for this picture, and that's, you know, gives it that illumination, that sort of enchantment, as you say. And also choosing a color scheme for a book for a particular painting in a book. In the case of, for instance, The 12 Dancing Princesses, which I retold and illustrated, it was my very first retelling, I decided that I wanted to key the whole book around what I would call the most central image. And for me, that was all the 12 princesses traveling through the golden wood. Mm. They travel through three woods, the golden wood, the silver wood, and the diamond wood. But somehow gold just evokes like light and warmth and just magic. So I designed the entire book around that image. Mm-hmm. And so you can imagine 12 girls traveling through woods that have golden leaves. Now the thought comes up, okay, what color would their dresses be? Because that really impacts the composition. So I decided that when they go into this underground kingdom, they would always have dresses that really have gold as the primary element. But I didn't have identical dresses. They were all a little different. Right. And I segued a little bit into green and a little blue. But that is as far as I went in terms of the gamut of color. You know, there are no purple, there's no orange, there's no, so I kept everything in that very close color range. And that's how I feel, with a strong composition, you can come up with a picture that's extremely unified. So half the book has that unification of those golden tones. And then I decided whenever they're in the upper kingdom, so they travel underground and then that's all the golden, the golden colors. And then I wanted the opposite when they were above ground. So then I did go to the purples and the blues and the those kind of opposite reds for when they are in the normal world. So there's a real difference between the two worlds.
So what you're saying is that you have conceptualized this whole story in your mind before and it's not just a series of individual paintings, but it's the whole thing is planned out. Wow.
I plan out the whole thing very carefully. I do a big book dummy with full rendered black and white in value tones. And then I also make notes on all the pages on what the colors are going to be. I don't do color studies. Mm-hmm. Now, this is something that surprises people because my work is so intricate and detailed.
Yeah.
I do the color studies in my head.
In your head, sure.
Because to have to paint it twice.
Sure.
I spend so much time with the research and taking photos of models and costumes to get the very realistic looking pictures.
Like you say, you get it right the first time. You don't have to go back and do it again.
Yeah. Right.
Now, you were telling me before about this is your latest book, A Castle of Cats, Castle Full of Cats. And if you have cats, folks, take a look at this because it's all about your cat. And so you were telling me that all of the illustrations for this story are watercolor because
the story is humorous, and all my other books have been serious fairy tales, which really called for that evocative oil painting style. And this book, this story, which I'd been working on for a number of years, was my first story in rhyme. It's a silly story about a queen that collects cats, and the cats drive the king crazy. And it's very funny. It's all sort of from tongue in cheek from the cat's point of view. They're trying to please the king by bringing him dead mice, etc.
That's right. So they do that.
So I did a first illustration for that, like a sample illustration, just to try out to see, what style I would be working in. And I'm comfortable with oils, so I painted the first picture in oils. And it didn't seem right. Yeah. It didn't seem right. It was a little too heavy, too dense.
Right.
I wanted the cats to be a little anthropomorphic, a little cartoony, and that style just didn't work with a traditional oil style.
Yeah.
So I went back and worked in watercolor, which I was a little afraid of because watercolors always scared me.
It's tricky.
But after after a number of missteps and
sure.
Trials, I did get back into the medium, mm-hmm. Which took a little while, but I feel like it really was a perfect medium for this story.
It's
lighter.
It's lighter. Yes. It's light filled, and the whole thing is lighter, and you catch that, not frivolous wave, but that light. That light
yes.
touch that you're, that whimsical touch that
whimsical,
you're trying,
that's
that
the
you're
word.
Trying to get at. Mm-hmm. That's great. So this is your latest book that's out in January.
Yes.
I suppose I would tell parents if you're at the library and if it's available, check it out. Mm-hmm. Especially if you have cats in the house.
Yes.
You know all about cats. They're crazy. You know, dogs have owners, but cats have staff. That's
yeah,
pretty
the
much how it
cats
is.
Really rule the castle.
They do.
They do.
They do, absolutely.
And I have three myself, and they rule our castle.
Yes.
And interestingly enough, a little anecdote about this story. When I first was working on it, my husband really was more of a dog person.
Yeah.
And now he's the king of the cats all dote on him.
Yes.
And he loves the cats.
Yes, that's not hard to do.
So, and I do too, so we both love the
now
cats.
I have a dog and a cat at home. And when I got the cat, he was just a little one, and the dog became his surrogate mother. And so my dog taught him everything that he needed to know about being a cat. They wrestle with each other and roll around and all that kind of thing. And now they're very close. And I'll go out to walk the dog, and the cat will follow us down mm-hmm. the street and around, and you know he's right there all the time. And oftentimes in the mornings when you know I see them on the couch and they're lying together or sitting together, at least you know as close as the cat will allow her to get. But it's very interesting. It was a very interesting thing to watch over the years how their relationship developed.
Mm-hmm. Well, there is a dog prominently.
Yes,
in
there
the
is
story
a dog prominently in the story. A very big dog.
That we're a little worried that bad things might happen, but it all turns out.
So we're going to talk about your latest work, which is utterly magnificent. And so the detail here is just astounding. And so tell us about this and where it's destined to go.
Well, this is a commissioned painting that will be reproduced on the wall, even larger than this, 7 feet wide, at the new Disney World, which is currently being built in Shanghai, China. So I was contacted by a company in Shanghai.
Wow.
And they wanted an Asian influence, mm-hmm. definitely, because a lot of the tourists that are going to be going to this new Disney World are going to be Asian.
Right.
So they definitely wanted an Asian influence, hence the cherry blossoms, the gardens, the elaborate gardens with fountains. So it's a little bit of a mix of Disney Asian mix.
This is almost like bonsai.
And also, their request was a little bit of an Art Nouveau influence, which interestingly kind of goes back to the Chinese. I feel that the Art Nouveau movement mm-hmm. was quite influenced by Chinese art. So now when you think of Art Nouveau, you think of one beautiful woman, say Mukka, with an ornate background. But what they wanted was a panorama with the castle at the top and Cinderella's coach going up to the castle.
Yeah.
So it was quite a challenge to think about merging all these different ideas.
Sure.
Chinese elements, Art Nouveau, mm-hmm. and a Disney panorama. So it was probably the most challenging job of my career
so far.
So, you know, so we've got some Art Nouveau kind of elements,
the
iris, and then I tried to emulate in the design kind of like that Art Nouveau sort of switchback.
Yeah.
You know, so it doesn't really have, you know, Art Nouveau, border or whatever, because
right.
it is a scene.
Yes.
Whereas the Art Nouveau often is a decorative, mm-hmm. it's more decorative.
Right.
It's like a figure with decorative elements around it, and that's not what they were requesting. So they were actually kind of requesting almost an impossible impossible task.
Yeah, but you rose to the challenge.
But the bridge is Art Nouveau.
Yes.
This is actually after a bridge in, I believe, in Central Park. And it is a nouveau design. Mm-hmm. I tried to make the coach a little nouveau-y.
With the embellishment there.
Yeah. The bridge, the bench, and just the design, and also the it is very detailed, but it's also a little flatly painted. You notice the water mm-hmm. is this is like a flat color with just these little squiggles. You know, it's not realistic.
Right.
So it's and then you know here's the you know more like a pattern. So I'm trying to incorporate.
Yeah.
Pattern.
Well, here you have the water lilies
as
that's
well,
very definitely,
and the water lilies. So it was really an interesting challenge.
Right up there, there's two cranes.
And the cranes are a Chinese, symbolically.
Yeah. The longer I look at this, the more there is to discover.
There are a few hidden things. There's a hidden unicorn, and
wow.
I even did a topiary Mickey, a hidden topiary Mickey.
A hidden one. Well, I'll have to look at it. Oh, there it is. No, that's the teddy bear. That may be Mickey. Anyways, this is just totally astonishing, and
thank you.
It's going to be in the new Disney World in Shanghai, China. Imagine that.
Yes.
And the exposure that you're getting from this is just going to be. I mean, this is. I don't know how to say this other than it's quite the achievement for anyone. But
thank you. I did want to try to knock it out of the park, and hopefully.
I think you did it.
Hopefully I've come reasonably close. One never is satisfied. I kind of hate it, but one always kind of hates a painting right after you finish it. And then, you know, in a couple years, I'll go back and look at it and go, oh, that's not too bad.
Because you think, oh, there's so many things I left out, or I could have tweaked it this way or that
way.
Right,
that's right, that's
right.
Artists are never satisfied.
No, that's
You just
right.
have to stop.
So let's talk about some more of your current work. And we're looking at the scratch board. So. You wanted to talk about that, so let's.
I did, yes. This is an illustration for my dream project, which is a Victorian fairy tale called The Golden Key, uh-huh. which when I read it over 30 years ago now, it's probably closer to 40 years, when I read this book, I said to myself, I want to illustrate that story
right.
someday. It was written by George MacDonald, mm-hmm. Who actually was lived a little bit before C.S. Lewis and was one of his main influences. Mm-hmm. And also Tolkien admired MacDonald.
Yeah.
He wrote a number of fairy tales and novels, fantasy novels. And The Golden Key was just one that just hit me. And I've just always wanted to illustrate it. It's quite long for a fairy tale, so it would not fit into a picture book format.
Right.
It's too long. So I decided to make it into a chapter book for children.
Mm-hmm.
So it will be probably 136 pages or so,
mm-hmm.
and it will be illustrated in black and white
yeah.
with about 45 illustrations.
Wow.
So I really wanted to illustrate every single thing in the story that really hit me, and there were that many of them. The little girl in the story is scared by the fairies, and she climbs out her window, and she runs into the forest. It's neat because there's a little boy and a little girl,
mm-hmm.
and they both are, they end up meeting up in the forest, but the boy has the golden key,
uh-huh.
and they want to find out what it unlocks.
Yes.
So that's the whole. But it has such great imagery in it. For instance, there are creatures called airfish, and it's a fish that flies. So it's got the body of a fish but the face of an owl.
Yeah.
And then later it turns into almost like a flying fairy
mm-hmm.
with wings.
Yeah.
So it's got a lot of metamorphosis themes in it.
Yeah.
A lot of mythology.
Right.
It's got Poseidon. It's got the old man of the sea, the old man of the, they meet the old man of the earth,
yeah.
the old man of the fire, and it's got so many just fascinating images in it, mythic
yeah.
images, that it's always just appealed to me greatly.
And this is on scratchboard.
Yes.
So it's black. Basically, it's black when you start. And
these start out, they're actually The manufacturer makes them white clay first, many, many, many layers of white clay covered with a layer of India ink. Uh-huh. And then you scratch it out with a very sharp tool. You can just use an X-Acto knife, even.
Yeah.
There are specialized tools, but X-Acto knives actually work quite well. And then you just scratch out, and you get down to the white. So you're just thinking in reverse. So you're thinking of drawing the light, which, if you recall, my earlier thoughts about designing a book, I always think about the light on the subject.
Right.
Even before I think of color, I think of light.
Yeah.
So this is like the pure light. So it has no color to distract you.
Right.
It's just pure light. So I'm just drawing what the light is hitting.
It's a, it's practically, well, like a photograph.
And that's my aim.
Yeah.
And I do, to assist me to make things look real, I do have reference.
Yeah.
So I do, you know, I do a lot of photographs. Mm-hmm. So I, you know, I have a picture of a model with a light. So I shine the lights on my models exactly the way I imagine them. Oh, in other words, I don't just shoot flash photography because that's a very flat light and it flattens everything out. Whereas if you're lighting from the side, that's a more dramatic light.
Right.
And the old masters all did the, you know, the light from the window. What's great is this is a new medium for me. I didn't, I guess in the last 5 years, I've really, I've done so many different new mediums.
Yeah.
And I didn't think I would be doing that. I thought I'd just be painting in oils forever. But here I, you know, I did the Castle Full of Cats in watercolor. This I did in oils, but it's very different style. You know, actually, I used pen also to outline everything in here.
Yeah.
So in addition to oil, oddly enough, I used pen to really make the lines very sharp. So that's something I've never done before. So
well, see, as an artist, you go from media to medium, and that's how you progress, and that's how you, you know, gain not maturity, I suppose, but your depth of experience.
How you grow.
Yeah, you
and,
grow.
And when you're an illustrator, and especially illustrating books, each book really dictates its style. At least, you know, you know, you just get a feeling that it needs something different, and that will match the tone of the words.
And
these start out. They're actually, the manufacturer makes them white clay first, many, many, many layers of white clay covered with a layer of India ink.
Uh-huh.
And then you scratch it out with a very sharp tool. You can just use an X-Acto knife, even.
Yeah.
There are specialized tools, but X-Acto knives actually work quite well. And then you just scratch out, and you get down to the white. So you're just, you're thinking in reverse. So you're thinking of drawing the light, which, if you recall, my earlier thoughts about designing a book, I always think about the light on the subject.
Right.
Even before I think of color, I think of light.
Yeah.
So this is like the pure light. So it has no color to distract you.
Right.
It's just pure light. So I'm just drawing what the light is hitting.
So, Ruth, we've been talking about all of your artwork and your illustrations and your writing, which has all been children's literature. Why is that?
Well, it goes back to art school. The year I was graduating, a children's book agent came to the school looking for artists, new artists to represent.
Huh.
And I, at that time, had not decided that children's books were going to be my focus.
Right.
I tried a little bit, as most people do in art school, tried a little bit of everything.
Right.
I had advertising work in my portfolio. I had, I wanted to do fantasy book covers.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in the adult market. Those different kinds of things. Editorial art.
Mm-hmm.
I was very enamored with editorial artists of the time, and was also given a almost like an internship with an editorial artist right out of art school.
Mm-hmm.
So his name was Mark English, and I kind of learned his editorial style.
Right.
And then the children's book agent had my children's work, and started getting me some work in the children's field, And I knew that I could be, I could almost be an imitator,
right,
of this, you know, editorial artist,
right,
or find my own way, my own style as a children's book illustrator,
right,
which would be completely different just by the subject yeah, matter. And then as I got more into it and started getting some jobs and getting some books to illustrate, I realized that, gosh, this really is what I want to do.
Uh-huh.
And any of the editorial jobs I got and the advertising jobs weren't much fun.
No.
They were like deadline, very stressful. And it was like a one picture. You know, it wasn't a sequence. It wasn't like a narrative. It wasn't like,
yeah,
you know, telling a story through lots of pictures. And as I started doing that more and more, getting jobs in the children's book field, I realized that, gosh, this is home. This is what I want to be doing. And
the way opened up.
So many of the artists I admired, like N.C. Wyeth, Howard Pyle,
yes,
illustrated books. And, you know, they are Arthur Rackham.
Norman Rockwell.
And Norman Rockwell. Well, he also was a magazine illustrator.
Yes.
So I admired him very much, too. But I tended to want to do just more than one picture, not just one picture. I liked the narrative, the
right,
sequence,
mm-hmm,
and I found that fascinating to start to learn to integrate words. And I started writing really as a retailer, so that mm-hmm was kind of how I got my foot in the door,
yeah,
so to speak. Retelling fairy tales.
Now, retelling means you revise the story or simplify it or change,
yes,
some aspects of,
yes,
it?
Yes. In the case of fairy tales, I liked to read many different versions. So, for instance,
yeah,
the French version is very different from the German version, mm-hmm, of any given story.
Yeah.
So I will read as many different versions as I can and then come up with a story that appeals to me.
Right.
because that's what retellers do. We're also reflecting our own sensibilities. Mm-hmm. And I've gone on to write some original fairy tales.
Mm-hmm.
And then The Castle Full of Cats,
yeah,
is my first book in rhyme,
mm-hmm,
which was really fun. I don't know if I'll write another one in rhyme.
Well, you never know.
But one never knows. I'm actually right now working on a retelling of a novel. Novelized version of Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. I think inspired by that little theme park cottage.
So.
And it's called A Dwarf's Tale.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah,
it's written from a dwarf's point of view with the premise that a dwarf,
yeah,
made the magic mirror for the queen,
yeah,
and what the consequences would be. I wear two hats.
Mm-hmm.
I also have passed down the writing aspect of,
yeah,
of what I do to one of my daughters.
Mm-hmm.
Whitney, who now is a children's book author as well, and a horse lover.
Yeah.
So she has written two books for Random House.
Her
first one was Golden Sun, and her second one was Darcy. And this is in a very successful series that Random House is doing called Horse Diaries. And each one is a different breed of horse,
mm-hmm,
told from the horse's view, set in a different time. So it's a bit of historic fiction. So this one is about Appaloosas, and it's,
yeah,
set in the Nez Perce territory,
oh, cool,
in like 1790. This one is set in Ireland in 1917, and it's,
mm-hmm,
a Connemara story.
Oh, yeah.
So it's right after the famine.
Yeah.
And it's a Connemara story. So I illustrate this series.
Yeah.
I do the covers and about 20 interior black and white illustrations.
Yeah.
So I'm very proud of my daughter.
Oh, you should be.
And then she has started a new series called Horse Rescue. And this one is a horse rescue in Old Chatham, New York,
yeah,
the oldest horse rescue in the United States. And
yeah,
this has become a passion of Whitney's. And then the next one will be actually in Palmer, Mass.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Blue Star
Blue
Equiculture.
Star. I know Blue Equiculture. Star well.
And they rescue a lot of draft horses.
My daughter
so
has
she's
a horse
currently
in that.
Working on a story based
yes
on one of their horses.
Yeah, my daughter and granddaughters are very involved with Blue Star. They go there all
it's
the time.
It's a wonderful, wonderful organization.
Yes, it's great people. And if you're anybody who's down that way, make a point of stopping by.
And Whitney is generously donating half her proceeds to the horse rescue facilities
yeah
that she's writing about,
yeah,
which is very generous.
So your latest project, and we've talked about your painting and your writing, and but there's other things going on that you are involved in that we should talk about because it's very interesting.
Well, I'm actually the co-director of a brand new MFA in children's book writing and mm-hmm. illustrating. In other words, merging both
right.
For people that want to be authors and illustrators, so that want to both write and illustrate picture books
yeah.
in particular. And the program is in Roanoke, Virginia,
mm-hmm.
and the school is Hollins University. Mm-hmm. And they've had a long-standing graduate program in children's literature where you could go and write you know, all sorts of books from, you know, from picture books up to, you know, young adult novels.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very long-standing program. And a few years back, they asked me to help them develop an illustration component to their mm-hmm. program.
Cool.
So I did I designed a certificate program in children's book illustration.
Yeah.
And then just last year, we were actually combining classes from both that certificate in illustration and the MFA in writing.
Yeah.
And we've come up with this brand new degree, which I feel is very exciting.
That's not only exciting, but it's we talked before about it, that it's so important to develop literature model for children, because we, over the years, in my involvement in library work, been involved with what used to be called 0 to 5, that if you read to your little ones picture books, simple languages, words, colors, that creates their development. It's important to do that, and because that's how children learn language and become literate in not only language but in visually as well. And it's important for them to do that, because when they get to school, they will have acquired those language skills that, you know, make them ready for the next stage in education. And public libraries in particular have been very, very active in this for a number of years, through programs, through storytelling, through, you know, pushing the books out the door and getting parents in to be part of that and to understand that this is not just a frivolous thing, you know, read to your kids when you have time, but this is really part of their education. And it's been particularly important for immigrant families as well, who are also learning English.
Yes.
But it's also more important for their kids for their children to learn, you know, English and become literate here and, you know, get into the educational model that we use. And they really have found that it makes a difference.
Of course.
And read, and we both, you and I both know, to read is to live. And it develops your imagination and, it not only your imagination, but your character as well. If you're really good.
That's exactly right. So, yeah, we're trying to get the next generation of writers and illustrators educated
yeah.
and, helping them to craft meaningful stories that both entertain and enlighten, and I don't want to use the word teach because
right.
We don't want to be didactic, but books that have some substance.
Well, children's literature has always had that teaching element. Grimm's fairy tales, like I said before, for me, reading them, you learn about good and evil, and all sorts of things about human behavior and how you navigate life.
Mm-hmm.
And
very silly book, A Castle Full of Cats. At its core, really, is about compromise.
Yeah.
It's about compromise, because the queen loves cats, the king doesn't, but then, he brings home a dog, and it turns out just fine.
Right.
In the end, its core has something.
Yeah.
Usually you try to disguise it so that it's not, here is the moral of the story.
Yeah,
one doesn't want to do that.
No.
But there has to be a heart, there has to be a beating heart behind the story.
Because it has to. This has been a wonderful, wonderful conversation, and look at your artwork and talk about what your life has been art-wise and what you're involved with now. It's been really good. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you for coming to my studio, and I enjoyed talking with you.
And for folks...
Ruth's studio is located at Cottage Street. It's number 307. It's very easily accessible, and she's also open during open studio time. And we're going to include her website address and email address on the credits of the program so that you can contact her if you want. So, from all of us to all of you, thank you for joining us today, and we'll see you next time on In Studio. Words would be relax, have fun, and rest easy.
And aloha.
Aloha. Aloha. Okay. Thank you.